What does a piece of ground signify? Place to mow, place to build, place to call home, place to worship. This piece of ground has supported children playing games during vacation Bible school, surrounded families as they played together, provided a piece of stability for a meal and fellowship. This piece of ground did not always look this way. Other buildings occupied this land. People who were not with us today put in their blood, sweat, and tears to make it viable. Other people who now sit with God in a heavenly realm claimed this rich earth. They gave of their time, their gifts, their energy, and their hard-earned dollars to establish something significant here. Since 1888, this piece of ground has transformed from dirt to grass, to concrete, to masonry and brick, and to building after building after building. But since 1888, the people of God have witnessed some great things here. Weddings, baptisms, revivals, celebrations, puppet shows, moments for learning, and funerals, and tragedies, and times of grief. It is what the church is supposed to be, a place of sharing Christ through our faith and our actions. Thank you for joining us for today's worship. Over the next few minutes, you will see some of the highlights of our ministries. And then, we will worship the God who has been here with the people for 133 years and for another 133 years to come.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I welcome you to our worship service today. This morning, we're going to be singing a song throughout the month of February that goes along with David. And so you're going to hear a lot about David this month. And so I went through and found a song that that really represents his life really well, but it's a new one. And I am very confident we have done a great job of singing new songs, and especially usually by that fourth week, we got it down pat. So this one is a very short one. You notice in the Faith We Sing hymn book, it is on 2058. The words are on the screen for you, but go ahead and if you want to go ahead and turn it there. And because it is a fairly new one, I'm going to invite Lindsay to play through once, and then what we'll do is we will sing through twice. So let's go ahead. Would all of you, if you're comfortable to stand, would you please stand?
Me, oh God, beyond my wants,
it's there. All right. So I think we'll continue to work on that. All right. I'm going to turn things over to Vicki as we have our opening prayer.
Okay. Please read the opening prayer with me. Teach us, good Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for any reward, except that of knowing that we do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Blessed Jesus, at thy word, let us sing hymn number 596. We gather now for a ritual of friendship. Let us take this opportunity and say good morning, hello to those gathered around us, and make sure you do a wave on the live stream. And after you've had an opportunity to do so, you may all be seated. do want to welcome you on the live stream and thank you for your patience. I know that several of you had an opportunity to check out. We spent both Wednesday and Thursday experimenting, doing various tests and things. We think we have it all taken care of, but we also kind of learned kind of a fail-safe as well. So just in case, but we got up and running and do welcome you on our live stream. And just as a reminder, this is the first Sunday of the month. We will be having communion. And so if you're watching at home, make sure to have your bread and juice available. And you may join in the communion time with us later on here in the service. I want to thank the ushers as they're handing out the attendance pads. That just lets us know of your record of attendance here this morning. Do have a couple of announcements to lift up. And I'm going to kind of do things chronologically. So the first one concerns the Super Bowl. And you probably remember this in years past. Whenever we have Super Bowl Sunday, we have something that is called the Super Bowl of Caring. And the Super Bowl of Caring has really come at a very timely moment. Our food pantry, which we call the Necessity Room, is low, and which means we've had a lot of folks that have come in to receive donations. And so you see right here on the bulletin is a list of specific items that we need. So as you gather for the Super Bowl next week and the Super Bowl of Caring, we invite you to bring one of these items with you to church next week and $1 bill. You certainly can bring more. We would love to have that, and it is also going to be Scout Sunday. And so the Scout Troop is 16. Scout Troop 16, which we sponsor, is going to be here, and we are going to honor them. But they're also going to count everything, because all we do is we just report it to the organization. And then youth groups all throughout the world, they report how much food is donated and how much money is raised. Everything stays here locally. So they're going to count it, and they're also then, once they are done, they're going to stack it in the Necessity Room. So I want to thank the Scout Troop that's going to be doing that next week. But we invite you to bring with you know, and that's why we printed it right here in the bulletin. These are the items of specific need in the Necessity Room. So when you go grocery shopping this week, if you want to cut this out, have this available with you, bring those items, we'll just kind of turn it over to Scout Troop 16 and just thank them so much for doing that. So that'll be next week for the Super Bowl of Caring. The following week, because of the Super Bowl, is going to be the Valentine's dinner. And the tickets are in the back there. They're $20 per person. All you need to do is just mark meat or chicken, which item you want, and we just keep the stub so that we can turn that into the menu item. And so that's in the table back there. I want to thank the Fergusons for allowing us to use their table. I know that you guys had some items, and will you be after church visiting? They've got some items that they're, as part of a fundraiser that they're doing, and so visit with them. But the tickets are located in the back there. And the other thing just to lift up, on Friday, I went over and spent some time with Francis Mix. Carol passed away. And so we want to lift up Francis in our prayer thoughts. I know at that time they were waiting for Carol's daughters to arrive. As of now, I do not know of any decisions that have been made, but please lift up Francis in your prayer thoughts and certainly thinking of him and all the family as God welcomes Carol Mix into his wonderful abode. So, other sharing this morning, joys, concerns? Yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah, you're going to come up? Okay, please do. Okay. Get the mic.
I'm taking donations for the school, stuff that we need.
Like what stuff do you need?
Supplies and fun stuff and stuff for teachers.
Our school is doing a fundraiser for our upcoming trips to Lincoln and the Litches. This fundraiser will help us pay for the gas, the bus, the hotel, and meals. Dylan's donation thing will be done on Friday, so he will not be here next week, but I will be here after church and next week with magazines that you can look through. You can also go online, and I believe there's more stuff online that you can buy.
Thank you very much for that update. Just some things from those that are watching online. So we got a note from one of our volunteers that helps out with the necessity room, and she said, this is from Becky Counts, we currently have 19 bags ready to go. However, the need has been high. And for anybody that's working in the office knows that it has gone by very quickly. And so you think, at one time we had a lot of food, and boy, it has gone really quickly. And then also received a note from Cinda, and she is requesting prayers. She is in the hospital, just right now, and many of you know that she is going through some cancer treatments, and because of her situation, the possibility of infection is really, really high. So she is asking for prayers as she is resting, as recuperating, and hope that all goes well so that that she can continue with her cancer treatments. Just received that this morning. Any other? Yes. Thank you for sharing that. So we've got a birthday today. So happy birthday to Tim, who's turning 50. And so we wish you well, Lori, as you get ready to start your new job at Potter's Will. Great ministry. And any other? All right. So let's go ahead and sing Happy Birthday. I'm going to invite now the children to come forward for our children's time. You want the bear? Okay, so you get the sheep. All right. So today, and actually throughout this month, we are going to be talking about David. And David is all about a shepherd. So tell me what do you know about shepherds? What do you know about a shepherd?
A shepherd herds sheep.
They herd sheep. So like what Dylan has here. Okay. Do you know anything else about shepherds? Now, do you think shepherds protect the sheep? Yeah. So when I was in Shadron, I knew somebody that was a farmer that had sheep. And I was amazed. All he had to do was say the words, and these sheep would listen to his voice. And then I would say, come here, sheepy, sheep, 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 sheep. And they would run away from me. So can you think of somebody that might be another shepherd that you might be thinking of?
Jesus.
Yes, in the Bible, Jesus gets referred to as a shepherd. And so it's really, really important. So I want us to think of not ourselves as sheep, but maybe as something where we listen to Jesus' voice. Now, one of the things, now bears, yes, you're right, bears eat, we're not going to be doing that right now. Bears do eat sheep. So it is the job of the shepherd to take a stick and bonk you on the head. All right, it doesn't matter if you have blue hair or not, to bonk you on the head and to protect the sheep. So I want you to watch today as we learn all about the shepherd. All right? Okay, all right, put the hands together. And might be able to do that. There you go. Might need to bring it and just repeat after me. Say, Dear God, thank you for being our shepherd as you protect us. Amen. All right, I will take the animals now. Yeah. But he's the church's. Okay, if you go and see Vicky, I think she has some candy for you. Oh, and also just received a note here. Today is Nicole Gosnell's birthday, and so we wish. So we've got two birthdays coming on today that we're celebrating. So for Tim and for Nicole. So wonderful as you celebrate with us here today. Let us turn to our prayer of confession and our prayer time here this morning. I invite you to read this with me together. You are our light, O God. In your presence, our lives are illumined. Our way becomes clear. Your own light comes from you. Like small candles lit from the Christ candle on Christmas Eve, we are able to shine with love and hope because you love us and give us reason to hope. Yet we confess to you, O God, that we often hide our light under a bushel, not trusting our perceptions. We do not share our truth with others. Not trusting our abilities, we do not risk sharing our gifts in community. Not trusting our skills and relationships, we do not reach out in friendship. We do not raise issues which should be raised. We do not break the silence of anger to give or seek forgiveness. Help us to trust in you where we cannot trust ourselves. Radiate through us with your holy love and wisdom, healing the hurts of the past, giving us courage for the future. Warm our coldness, relax our tight muscles, give us clarity and peace. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who came to reveal your light to the world. Amen. Let's use this time to pray silently. Lord, we gather in your presence here today. We just ask that the week that we had, we lift up those that responded to our need. Maybe it was a coworker. Maybe it was a friend. Maybe it was someone that just reached out. Maybe it was a neighbor that scooped our sidewalk. Maybe it was someone that just kind of warned us about an icy patch. Maybe it was someone that let us in the line. Maybe it was something that we celebrated this week and we only kept it to ourselves. Dear Lord, there's so much that we lift up to you in our prayer time. Dear Lord, we lift up the Mix family and just ask that you surround Francis right now. Be with Carol's daughters as they make plans to celebrate her life. Be with those that are celebrating birthdays today and this week. Be with those that, as we go shopping, and we've got some means, maybe purchase something a little extra for those that are just hungry right now. Be with those that are in the hospital, and we say a special prayer for Cinda. Be with those in our congregation at Central. Dear Lord, we know that COVID has run the gamut there, and we've got a lot of ill folks in our sister congregation. These prayers and those that we can't find words for are brought to your lap. Be with us, not only as we pray for those in our prayer list, but those that we think about and those that we can't find words for, especially now as we pray to you together our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us join in singing verse 1, Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken.
Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion City of our God. God's word cannot be
reading is 1 Samuel 16, verses 1 through 13. David is anointed as king. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is this now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made 7 of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all of your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him, Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David. From that day forward, Samuel then set out and went to Ramah.
Vicki, thank you.
You bet.
I'm going to do something that I have never, ever done before. I'm going to lead us in a sermon series that is actually done by someone else. Today, and actually through this month of February, is very humbling because, one, I do not have the means to go to Israel. And two, you do not have the means to send me to Israel. And finally, we do not have the technical capabilities to do justice to this sermon series. So here's what we're going to do. Throughout the month of February, we are going to do what many churches are actually doing, is we are going to become a satellite worship service of the largest United Methodist Church in our conference, Church of the Resurrection. But before we go to that video, I want to ask you a couple questions. So the first question, and shout it out. What do you know about David? Let me know. What do you know about David?
He wasn't perfect.
He was not perfect. What else?
He was a poet.
He was a poet.
He beat Goliath.
He beat Goliath, yeah. He was a shepherd. Yep, we got that one. We talked with the kids about that. Maybe this one is a little bit easier. What do you think you know about David? He was the Lord's anointed. Yeah.
He was imperfect.
He was imperfect. Yeah. Well, today, we're going to, as you can see in the outline, each week we're going to be talking about one of those aspects of David, and today is all about the shepherd. So we invite you to, we're going to have the lights turned off, we invite you to watch this video, and we'll have a little bit more discussion after we're done.
Hi, I'm Art Nemetoff. I'm the senior rabbi of the Temple Congregation B'nai Yehuda.
And I'm Adam Hamilton, the senior pastor at the United Methodist Church of the Resurrection. And we are really excited to be joining you for a sermon series, Walking in the Footsteps of David. And we are actually literally walking in his footsteps. We're standing here in a shepherd's field in Bethlehem. In the time of David, the city of Bethlehem, a town of Bethlehem, maybe had a couple hundred people. Today there's over 100,000 people who live here, and you're going to hear the sounds of traffic whirring by as we're standing here. But our aim is to help us together explore the significance of this person who is so important in our faith. Why is David so important, and how important is he really in our faith?
Well, David's a foundational figure both in Judaism and Christianity. If you look at the Bible, the Old Testament, what Jews call the Jewish Bible, you see that David's name is mentioned 1,000 times, more than Moses, more than Abraham. Half the Psalms are ascribed to David. He is an important figure. He was a shepherd. He was a warrior. He was a king. He was a prophet to a certain extent. And we need to understand what his life was, because in fact, we reflect his life, and his life reflects our own lives.
Right. I think people are so fascinated by David and really throughout all history, because as you look at him, you see both what we hope to be. At his best, he's somebody who was a man after God's own heart, who God loved. And his name, in fact, means beloved. So he was loved by God. He was loved by many others. We want that. But we also look at his story and we see he was kind of a mess sometimes. He was power hungry. There were times he abused his power. There were many things where we look at David and say, I don't want to be that, but we also recognize we are that in some ways.
Right. All of us are messes at times in our lives, and we need to figure out ways to get rid of that mess and be the beloved of God that David was to the Holy One. So together, let's explore his story. We begin here in Bethlehem, and let's start where he began, that as a shepherd.
Yeah, and the location of Bethlehem for David's life really goes back, what, two generations before that, to his great-grandmother.
Goes back to Ruth. Ruth is known in Jewish tradition, at least, as the prototypic Jew by choice, the one who chose to believe in God and believe in one God. And she said, your people shall be my people, your God, my God. She was considered such a model of piety that her great-grandson would become the greatest king that Israel ever known, King David, and that's who we're going to learn about now.
Right, and if you travel through Bethlehem, the things that you see today, for Christians you come, there's one central point you come to, and that is the Church of the Nativity at Manger Square. And so many of you, I've taken to this place before, and we've seen this place where Jesus was said to have been born in a cave, in a stable. But as you travel throughout this land, you find shepherd's fields, you find the fields of Ruth and Boaz, you find all of these stories that are important in our faith. So you've had a chance to see a little bit of Bethlehem. We want to take you outside of Bethlehem to meet a shepherd named Omar. Omar began shepherding when he was 6 years old, and at the age of seven, he was left by his family out in the wilderness with the sheep, and forced to find his way back home. We wanted you to have a chance to hear from Omar what it means to be a shepherd, because David began his life as a shepherd boy. So let's head outside of Bethlehem and let's meet Omar. It's huge.
Shepherd.
So I'm with Omar, and we're in the wilderness of Judea. This is the desert of the wilderness where the Bedouin graze their sheep. And Omar is both a university student and a shepherd, and he's going to tell us a little more about that.
The main thing for us when we go with the sheep in the wilderness is to feed the sheep.
And so you're looking for places where there's grasses growing, or how do you know where to take them?
Every day we go around here and we discover the areas that we find plant, we find grass, and we find something for the sheep to eat. And we noticed when the sheep are having enough food from the area, so we continue go to this area until we find that the sheep have enough food in this area, so we change the place.
How does a shepherd care for his sheep?
The water is one of the main things when I take care of the sheep. If I didn't find water in my way, I need to return to the home, even if it's noon yet, because I don't want them to feel thirsty, and this will make them like sick. So I need to find the water for them.
What about protecting your sheep? How does a shepherd protect his sheep and goats, and how and what are the predators for them?
We depend on dogs. They come with us, and we take care of these dogs in order to take care of the sheep with us. And if we saw a wolf or fox or something, so we start to shout, and as soon as we shout, the dog will attack these animals. The dogs, they don't allow any strangers or any animals to be in between our sheep.
Do the sheep and goats, do they know your voice? Do they recognize your voice? And do they come when you call them?
The sheep, they know me and they know my voice, and I have a specific voice that they hear this voice, they come to me as fast as they can.
Do you use your rod to guide the sheep, or how do you guide the sheep?
The main thing is the voice. I use this stick to freight, you know, them, to make them feel fear if they are going outside. So I use this stick in order to, if I found a snake, I killed it with this stick, or any animal that want to attack. This sheep was tired. So I'm afraid that she will be late, and you know, wolves or fox will eat it. So I help her and carry her to put it with me and the donkey to make her feel rest and comfortable.
What does it take to be a good shepherd? Describe what a good shepherd is like.
The good shepherd is the one that he stay all the time with his sheep and don't leave them without he being with them. And he need to walk with them slowly and not to make them tired. And he need to provide the water for them in the right time.
What do you love about doing this?
إذا كان عندك حب للرعي الغنم راح تنجح وراح يكون كل شيء تمام الرغبة.
Yeah, you need to have a good desire and love in taking care of the sheep.
حرفة الرعي هذا الحرفة.
Because this one, this thing to be a shepherd, it need love. You know, like you need to love what you are doing, and if you have the love to do what you, you know, as a shepherd to do this, it give you a successful leading to the sheep.
الأنبياء والرسل اللي كانوا أفضل منه.
And this life was the lifestyle of the prophets in the Old Testament, and you know, like most of the prophets, like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and David, they all was having this, and they are better than us. But you know, like we are the followers of what they was doing. I want to thank you for doing this. You know, like the Bedouins' life now are under dangers. So like when you focus on this, you like give us hope.
So it was really awesome to have a chance to see Omar and hear him talk about what a good shepherd does. And of course, you can't help but think about David in the 23rd Psalm. And as I was walking back from the wilderness where we were, where we'd driven the sheep or the goats, I found myself reciting over and over again the 23rd Psalm. I just felt this sense of peace. And imagine David out there with the sheep and composing these words. So I'm just curious, in the rabbinical tradition and in the Jewish tradition, what does the 23rd Psalm mean? Why is it, or is it important in the Jewish tradition? And what does it mean for you and for your people?
Well, the 23rd Psalm is foundational for both Judaism and Christianity. In Jewish tradition, it is part of our liturgy that we read when someone dies, because there's a sense of comfort that we receive knowing that God is with us in our times of struggle. When we talk about walking in the valley of the shadow of death, literally that's often what happens, but there are other times when we walk in that valley of the shadow. Those are times when we struggle with life, when things aren't going exactly the way we want them to go, and we need help. And that's when we turn to God, who is both our shepherd and our savior. And you know, all of us have the ability to be shepherds just like David was. And I think that's the eternal message of the 23rd Psalm, that each of us has that ability. Let me tell you a story about a woman I know. She had breast cancer, and when she got done with her treatment, she went to go buy a bra, and there was no one there with her. It was one of the loneliest moments of her life. And so she made the decision that every time that she knew a woman who had breast cancer, she volunteered to go with them to help them buy their first bra as a way of supporting them. Each of us in life need to be that kind of a shepherd. We need to shepherd our friends, our family, even strangers that we meet.
Yeah, so God was choosing David, a shepherd, because he had that tendency to take care of the vulnerable or the weak, and we saw that in what Omar was saying, the shepherd does for the sheep. I love that picture of all of us are called to be shepherds for others. We're all called to be like David, to care for the people, and that's why David was called to care for Israel. So as I think about the story, of course, we have Samuel is told by God that God has is going to choose a new king, that he's taken his favor away from Saul, King Saul. And he says, I want you to go to the house of Jesse, who was a shepherd in Bethlehem. And he says, I want you to find one of Jesse's sons. One of his sons I've chosen to be the next king of Israel. So Samuel shows up at Jesse's house. He says, you know, one of your sons is going to be the next king. Bring them to me. And he brings his oldest son to Samuel. And Samuel looks at him and says, yeah, he's the one. He's strapping and strong and, you know, handsome and smart and tall. And God says, no, not this one. And so he says, well, do you have another son? And he brings his second oldest son, you know, handsome, strapping, strong. And God says, no, not this one either. I mean, both times Samuel looks at him and says, yeah, that must be the one. God says, no, that's not the one. And the third and the fourth and the fifth and the sixth and the seventh. And finally, he's out of sons. And Samuel says, well, surely you have another son. And Jesse says, well, yeah, there's the young one, the child. He's out there taking care of the sheep, you know, doesn't even name him. And Samuel says, well, go get him, bring him in. And so he brings him in, and Samuel looks at him, and God says to him, yeah, he's the one. And I love this line. He says, you look at the outward appearance. Humans look at the outward appearance. I look at the heart. And God had chosen David to be the next king of Israel. Now, this would be years before he was actually anointed as king. But I love this picture. And part of what it speaks to us, I think, about is how God chooses the unlikely. It's God choosing the ordinary, God choosing the ones that are the least likely to succeed. And we see that consistently in the Bible. We see it starting with Abraham, who with Sarah are an elderly couple and can't have children. God says, out of you will come a nation and they will be a blessing to all the nations of the earth. Can you think of other examples?
And God saw it in Moses. Moses was a stutterer. He couldn't speak, and yet he was challenged to go before Pharaoh and free the children of Israel. Throughout history, we have the experience of the one who is least likely arises to become the one who is truly our hero. Adam, are there experiences in your life, in your church that you have that you could share that would?
So I think of a couple stories. One is when I was in high school. I was a freshman in high school, Blue Valley High School, and there was a man going door to door knocking on doors. He knocked on my door. He spoke with what was what's called an electrolarynx, pressed to his throat. His vocal cords had been removed. He was nothing much to look at. And he knocked on my door and he said, I'm just going door to door inviting people to church. I notice you're new in the neighborhood and I'd like to invite you to come to church with me. His name was Harold Thorson. And after all of these years, I still remember his name. And invited me to church. And that invitation and his willingness with a disability to go door to door inviting people to church changed my life. And today, Church of the Resurrection exists in part because Harold Thorson was going door to door with a disability, inviting people to come to church, and God used him in a profound way. When I was in college studying for the ministry, I remember getting a check from him, and he was living on disability, and he sent me a check and said, "I just want to help you with your schooling." But I think about, there's hundreds of examples in both of our congregations. The other one that many of your folks may know as well is Jeff Hansen, who as a boy had a tumor on his optical nerve, was legally blind. And his parents, it was very discouraging, but his parents said, "No, we believe that God is going to use our son in some profound way." And he had the gift for creating art. And today, Jeff is 25 years old and is known around the world for his art. And I was at his house just recently. He had an open house, and he's given away now $4 million. $4 million a 25-year-old young man has given away. And his goal is to give away $10 million by the time he's 30 years old. And I think, other people would have dismissed him and said, "Well, what's going to become of this kid?" But instead, his parents and his faith and God working through him took a young man who was most ordinary, and even some would say struggled with a disability, and did something so amazing. His story's been told around. And so this is the idea. God takes the ordinary, and God can take you. Whatever your gifts, abilities, your life experiences, you may feel like you have nothing to offer. And God says, "No, I can use you to do something amazing and dramatic if you'll just let me." And that's in part the story of David being chosen by God to shepherd his people.
Each of us has the ability to be just like that, to be the David, the shepherd, the one who cares for the ones who need caring, and the one who is least likely to care, the one who didn't have a name. David originally didn't have a name, but we know what David's name is. It means beloved. And each of us can be beloved to others and to God if only we consider what we can do for them. And let us strive to do that each day in our lives.
So God takes the ordinary and he does something extraordinary with it. And that's what we remember while we're standing here. This is a pretty amazing place. And, the shepherds like David would have had their sheep across this land all the time, and they would have stood back in awe of a God who takes the ordinary and does something extraordinary with it.
Adam, that's exactly what God did with David, and that's what God does with us. God allows us who consider ourselves to be ordinary to do extraordinary work each and every day of our lives. All we need to do is trust in God, and God will be there to support us, to allow us to do those great things, just as David did in his life. And now, Adam, I feel compelled that we ought to recite the 23rd Psalm in this place.
Yes.
But I'd rather us go to another place called the Valley of the Shadow of Death. And there in the Judean desert, let us together recite the 23rd Psalm with our congregation.
Let's make our way to the Valley of the Shadow of Death.
Look at this incredible view. This is called the Valley of the Shadow of Death. Well, we all walk in the Valley of the Shadow of Death sometimes. We say that for comfort because we believe that God will protect us, God will watch over us, God will set a table before us in the presence of our enemies. The enemies aren't always real. enemies are sometimes internal. There are emotional enemies. The 23rd Psalm is one of those pivotal pieces of literature in our world that offers comfort and inspiration at the same time.
And I think it'd be great if we not only pray the 23rd Psalm, but if you all would join us in this. And so we'd like to invite you to join us in reciting the words that appear on the video screen.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you, Adam.
Thank you.
Adam, I want to thank you so much for reciting the 23rd Psalm with me. But most of all, I want to thank you for being a friend and being my shepherd, as together we're walking in the footsteps of David here in the Holy Land, in the land of Israel. I know this is only the first step of the journey, but I look forward to our continued time together. Where are we going next?
Yeah, well, first of all, I want to reiterate that with you and just say thank you, Art, for being my friend and a shepherd as well. This has been a lot of fun so far, and it's going to be even more exciting in the coming weeks. So we head to the Valley of Elah, where we're going to remember David slaying the giant Goliath, and then we're going to head to En Gedi next week, and we're going to see the place where David could have killed Saul but chooses not to. This is in the midst of jealousy and fear, and we're going to find in those two lessons a picture of how we slay the giants in our own lives and also how we demonstrate character towards other people. So we look forward to seeing you next week. God bless.
Shalom.
So what are your images of a shepherd? Very different than what you saw here. We tend to think of a shepherd as going along grassy meadows and still waters, but what you saw here, a shepherd is really desperate for food and water for those sheep. Amazing. John Goldenier is a scholar. And he says something really unique about Psalm 23. He says, the psalm is encouraging us to declare our trust that we can face being threatened by the human equivalents of bears, rattlesnakes, and cougars, because God protects us, it should be protects us, with his club like a shepherd protecting his sheep. I'm reminded of the first time I ever preached on Psalm 23. It was my first funeral. And you ask any pastor about their first funeral service, and they will always bring that up. And I remember that the family requested that Psalm 23 be used for their mom. And the mom, she had a son and a daughter, and what was unique is the son and the daughter did not get along. In fact, I had to meet with both of the son and daughter separately because they could not be in the same room. And yet when I met with them, and the reason they requested Psalm 23 is because they both talked about the family dinners that they would have when they were younger. And so I thought, okay, here I am preaching this funeral text, talking about Psalm 23. And I use that text to talk about sometimes we sit around the table with our enemies. And I talked about a future blessing that we need to have. And I said that Psalm 23 is that future blessing. Now, I don't know. I moved away from that community. I don't know if that son and daughter ever got into the same room again, but certainly they heard the message of a shepherd that talks about the future blessing. Let us pray. Dear Lord, I just thank you so much for this technology, for those that can bring this image of Israel and David and the shepherd, and certainly of Jesus alive to us. I just ask that we become the shepherds that you want us to be. And for this, continue to walk with us in your future blessings. In your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to turn things over now to our ushers who are with us as we respond to God, and then we will have our moment of communion. invite you, all of you, to turn to page 17. And this will be our prayer of thanksgiving. This is our response. So I invite you to read this responsibly with me. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. You may all be seated. It is right and a good and joyful thing to give thanks to you, Almighty God. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread with those present at the table, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this as often as in remembrance of me." And then after the supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, shared it with those at the table, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. As you saw during the message and during that video, why Jesus is referred to as the shepherd. Think about those that were walking around at Jesus' time. And what they saw, the image that they had was of David. David was the great shepherd. And so when they started hearing these stories and they heard about Jesus, and of course, the one that I'm thinking about, and many of you, raise your hand. You remember the image of Jesus kind of having the sheep draped around the shoulder? I remember that growing up in Sunday school and seeing that. And I thought about that sheep or that goat that was on the horse. You know, and the shepherd says, I'm keeping this away because if I leave this out, it's going to be eaten. And so, you know, that's the image of the great shepherd. And so we come here participating in probably the ultimate act of the great shepherd who guides us, who walks with us, and then reminds us that we are shepherds to other people. So what we're going to do is we've got communion. For those of you that are present here personally, we invite you to come forward. We have kind of spaced out along these communion rails. We invite you to come and kneel if you are able. If not, just go ahead and stand. We've got them in individual cups. And for those sitting on this side of the church, you may come down and use this railing. Those sitting on this side of the church, you may use this railing. Let us know if you need to have communion brought out to you. And thank you. And also, as you are coming forward, not as a member of this church, but of simply wanting to feel the need of the shepherd in your life, we invite you to come forward. I will be sharing communion with those at home and take this opportunity to be the shepherds for someone else. So I invite you to come now. And for those of you worshiping at home, the body of Christ broken for you. The precious blood of Christ shed for you. Let us read together our benediction. Eternal God, I give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to me. Grant that I may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give myself for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you now, if you are comfortable to stand, would you please stand as we conclude our worship service today. Come, Christians, join to sing. Hymn number 158.